Welcome to the second lecture on linear algebra. So, in this session, first I would like to introduce with you about 3D vectors, which perhaps many of you haven't worked before. So, we have a 3D axis here. This one is x-axis, this one is y-axis, staying onto the board, while the z-axis is coming out of the board. Yeah. To make it simpler, you can also think it like this, that x and y coordinates as being like the floor, as if you were looking at the corner of a room and the x and y being the directions of the floor, okay, while z axis being the height of the room. And sometimes we call this as a 3D space. So let us consider a point in the space, say at here, say 3, 1, 2. Okay, so what does it mean? It means that we are moving 3 unit along x-axis, 1 unit along y-axis, and 2 unit along z-axis. And by joining this point with the origin, we construct a vector, say alpha, passing through the origin. Okay. So, as we have seen in our last lecture, that a vector can be represented in a row form. Or in a column form, vector can also be represented in a component form, you know. So the component form for two-dimensional vector, we have I cap and j cap, while for three-dimensional vector we have I cap, j cap and k cap. Along the positive x direction, positive y direction and positive z direction. So for example, in this case we would have 3 I cap plus 1 j cap plus 2 k cap. So here I cap, j cap and k cap are known as unit vector, or it's sometimes also called as base vector. And we have I cap equals 1, 0, 0, j cap equals 0, 1, 0, and k cap equals 0, 0, 1. Therefore, the implication is we are moving 3 unit along positive x direction, 1 unit along positive y direction, and 2 unit along positive z direction, which will finally get you back to this alpha 3, 1, 2. Similarly, we also have minus I cap, minus j cap and minus k cap, which respectively implies the negative x direction, negative y direction and negative z direction. Now that we know that a vector is represented by directions and length, we will now talk of its basic arithmetic operations. The simplest thing that you might want to do if you have a couple of vectors is to add them up. Okay. Let's think about the vector addition first. What does it mean? So given two vectors, say alpha and beta, let's make it alpha equals to 3, 1, 2 and beta equals 1, minus 5, minus 1. Now, if you want to add these two vectors together, we will write that out. So what does this mean is we need to add it on the respective components of vector alpha and beta. And so on down, the procedure is very simple. So adding them up, we obtain 3 plus 1, 4, 1 plus minus 5 equals minus 4, and 2 plus of minus 1 equals 1. Here you go. Now, how about scaling a vector? So, what we can do is, we can simply multiply a vector by any scalar number, and correspondingly, we will just end up multiplying each of its components. So let's take the example of alpha. If we are just multiplying by minus 2, we obtain minus 2 times 3 equals minus 6, minus 2 times 1 equals minus 2, and minus 2 times 2 equals minus 4. So we are just multiplying in a component by component basis. Let us look another example. So we choose gamma equals 5 minus 10, 20. In this case, what we notice is each of the three components is a multiple of 5, yeah? Therefore, we can just take out this common factor out in front and write this instead as 5 times 1 minus 2, 4. With these definitions of addition and scalar multiplication, or else you can also say it as a scaling, in our hand, we will now discuss about different arithmetic operation on vectors. Okay, so if I have two ordinary numbers, maybe real or complex, whatever, say x and y, then of course we know that x plus y is the same as y plus x, yeah? I am not saying anything fancy here. It is as simple as we know that 3 plus 4 is 4 plus 3. Yes? This is called commutative property. Yeah? Did you remember that we have learned this in the lecture series of real numbers? So we know that real numbers or complex numbers, addition, both follow the commutative property. Now, if we think about the same statement for vectors, is it true that vector alpha plus vector beta is same as vector beta plus vector alpha? Well, it must be, because just now we have learned that vector addition is component wise, yeah? So basically, whenever we are adding vector alpha with vector beta, what we are doing, we are adding each component of alpha with the corresponding component of beta. And since this addition is dealing with the ordinary numbers, therefore, addition of vectors should be commutative. So, vector addition is commutative, yes? You can verify yourself by taking any example, or else you can also take these examples of alpha and beta and check it by yourself. And you will find that alpha plus beta equals beta plus alpha. Now let us consider three ordinary scalar quantity, x, y and z. We know that x plus y plus z equals x plus y plus z. So is the same thing also follow in case of vector addition? Yes, of course,
it is going to have to be true to vectors also. Because the answer is same. The way we define vector addition, it is to adding component to the corresponding component. And it is just addition, yeah? That is, it doesn't matter in which way we add three vectors. The answer will remain same. Alright, so vector addition follows commutative property and associative property. We will now focus one more important property related with the scaling property. It's called distributive property. Let C be any scalar, real or complex number, doesn't matter. We will show now that C times alpha plus beta equals C times alpha plus C times beta. Well, the procedure is very simple. Since multiplication is component wise, we have C times alpha equals 3C, C and 2C. Similarly, C times beta is C minus 5C and minus C. Now, if we add this, we obtain 3C plus C. Since addition is component wise, we obtain 4C minus 4C, C. Now, what about C times alpha plus beta? We know alpha plus beta, this 4 minus 4, 1. Now, multiplying this quantity with C, we obtain 4C minus 4C, C. So, observe that vector addition is distributive. Please verify yourself by taking different example and you will obtain same answer. The underlying fact is we are dealing with regular ordinary numbers. The each component is basically a regular numbers. And all these numbers, whenever we are dealing with the addition operation, have this property. Commutative property, associative property, distributive property. Henceforth, this thing is also following in case of vector addition also. So this is very important thing, as what we have learned from today's lecture, that vector addition maintain the same property as like real or complex numbers.